to BFC Liverpool Online Service! Woo!
Jesus. 5 lessons from lepers, and we read from Luke 17, verse 11 to 19. You don't have to open your Bible, it will be on a slide. So one of the things that I want us to understand very clearly is that God is a sovereign God. He's all-powerful. He is a God that can and do miracles. Last weekend, we had the privilege of seeing or being at the conference where the heavenly man was, Brother Jung. And one of the key things that he said in the Chinese church, it's called the impossible God. What we think is impossible is even the start where God is. Just one other thing, 30,000 people come to Christ every day in China at this stage. How good is that? How good is that? Any case, but it was a fantastic time. And one of the things about God is he is beyond our imagination. But there's a paradox here. And I want you to hear me out, because the Bible never promises our lives to be free from pain and difficulties. Instead, the Bible promises us that we will have many trials and tribulations. It's not a good sales pitch, but it's the truth. He also gives us the answer for these things. You see, the secret to success, to a successful life, is knowing where to turn to for help. So God is a sovereign God of love. He's full of compassion, and he can, and dare I say, without being misunderstood, he will bring healing in his time and place. My aim is to draw lessons from the life of a man who had leprosy. So let's read from the Bible. Come on. Oh, we have to turn on, obviously. Come on. Back. There we go. So, read from the New International Version. Now, on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee, and he was going into a village. 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice and said, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." When he saw them, he said, "Go, show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw he was healed, came back praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, "Were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Has no one returned to give praise to God except this foreigner?" And to be fair, it was more than a foreigner. The Samaritans were like not full on Jews, and were inbred with the other tribes. So they were not seen even as equal to Jews. Then he said to him, "Rise and go. Your faith has made you well." Now the obvious lesson here is that Jesus healed 10 men of the illness of leprosy, and only one came back to thank him. And you may say to me, "Yeah, and?" Let me explain. As we study the New Testament, we find Jesus performed many miracles and shared many parables. And one of the key things that I want to leave with you, and you can go and think about it, is that in every miracle is a hidden parable, and in every parable is a hidden miracle. So on the surface, Jesus heals 10 men, and only one returned to thank him. But in addition to this miraculous healing, there are some really very valuable spiritual principles to be found. The first one is, we can identify with this leper. Because guess what? We have a deadly problem, and only Jesus can fix it. You see, in biblical times, leprosy was a terrible problem. The word was often used to describe skin diseases. Now, modern doctors think that it is Hansen's disease, and it starts with a white patch on the skin, and it becomes numb, that piece of flesh. And so the victims can't feel a needle that it pierces, if it pierces on the spot. Then this patch begins to spread all over the body and often manifests into the face. When it hits the face, you can't hide it anymore. And when it hits the face, it is so close to killing him, because now it goes to the internal organs and it starts to make all the flesh inside like that as well. However, sometimes, or actually not sometimes, they believe that over 65% of people don't die of leprosy, but actually of accidents. Because when a leper put, for instance, a hand in a flame, doesn't feel it. And when it doesn't feel it, they burn. And sometimes they fall and they don't know that they broke something. And so eventually they die more of accidents and diseases than leprosy. So lepers in biblical times were called the walking dead. They were kicked out of the city. They were not allowed to live with their family. They had to go live at the gates of the cities in colonies where they were beggars. The family don't want to take food to them because they're unclean according to the laws. And you know, that is our spiritual state. You and I have leprosy of the soul, because we have sin in our lives, terminal sin, and that causes us to be spiritual outcasts. We were in a way kicked out of the city, out of heaven, out of the Garden of Eden by Adam and Eve with the original sin. And that sin has been given to them and our parents. So we actually inherited from our parents, they inherited from their parents, etc., etc., etc. Now we have that, but one of the key things is, I just need to do this, why is it struggling? And even God in Isaiah 1, 4-7 says the following of humans. He says this: it's a sinful nation, a people loaded with guilt, a brood of evildoers, children given to corruption. And they've forsaken the Lord. They've spurned the Holy One of Israel and turned their backs on Him. From the sole of your feet to the top of your head, there's no soundness, only wounds and welts and open sores, not cleanse or bandage or soothing the soul. Not really very nice. Written 2,700 years ago. And I think you will agree with me that God could repeat the same to us. The Old Testament prophets teach us that God holds both individuals and nations accountable for sin and immorality. I believe and I trust, I'm not saying something here that's controversial, but for me, studying prophecy is not so much about figuring out obscure symbols and signs as it is hearing God calling us to repent from our sin and turn to Him. Some prophecy experts are spending hours trying to figure out the meaning of symbolism that may or may not be of consequence. However, God say, hey, you guys, stop. Look right in front of you. You live in a world that is sick of sin. And you do not have to be prophetic or have a prophetic vision to understand that. We may feel healthy today, but if you and I don't have a personal relationship with Jesus, there is a terrible, invisible, aggressive cancer growing inside of our souls. It cannot be detected by MRI or by CAT scan or any other medical diagnostic tool. But God says it's there. And what are we about to do about this illness called sin? The answer is right in front of us. We should do the same thing as these 10 men did. Admit the problem and cry out to Jesus. These 10 lepers banded together, stood up when they saw Jesus, and they decided this is time. They want to do business. There was no small talk about the weather. There was no small talk about Jewish politics or the right of wrong of being having a Samaritan law or anything. There was no small talk about sport or about the latest chariot races. No, they had one thing in mind, and that was Jesus, Master, have pity on us. Now think with me. It would have been easy for these men to look at each other and to say, but hey, we're not so bad. We're all in the same condition. One of them could have said, my leprosy is not as bad as yours, so I'm doing okay. Instead, they said, no, we've got a problem. We're going to die. We need to get some help. Too many people are living in denial because they look around and see others worse than themselves. So they do not admit them. Be careful here, friends. Because we live in a spiritual leper colony called the United Kingdom. There are plenty of chances to think, I'm not so bad. I have never robbed a bank. I've never murdered anybody. I'm not a drug dealer. I'm not a child molester. In fact, some of us may sit here today and think, I'm actually very good. For heaven's sake, I'm in church. Right? Before Jesus can help us, we must quit fooling ourselves and admit we have a problem. However, that's not enough. Because we have to cry out to Jesus. And let me give you a practical example. My previous job, I worked with people in addiction. All rehabilitation programs starts with admitting the problem. I'm addicted to alcohol. I'm addicted to pornography. I'm addicted to cocaine, gambling. But that's not enough. It must follow with an action. And that action is the greatest counseling phrase ever. Stop it. Stop it. Our actions as sinners, after admitting the fact that we have a disease called sin, to accept Jesus as our Savior, and build a relationship with God, and to live according to His Word. However, this process starts with, sorry Jesus, I'm a rotten sinner. Jesus, have mercy on me, help me. When I'm prepared, I have to ask myself the question, have I angrily to blame God for my sin? Have you done that? Or have you come to a place of total surrender where you said, God, be merciful to me, a sinner? Now, my point why I say, have I asked God? Is it His or blame God for my sin? Think about Garden of Eden. What's the first thing Adam say when God comes to say, it's not me, it's the woman? And then he turns around and say, and God, if you didn't make her, this wouldn't have happened. Are we doing that? Admit, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Hear God and act in faith. It's interesting to realize that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem to be crucified and redeem mankind when the lepers called out to him. Yet he still had time to stop and help them. To apply to us, God is busy holding the universe together, but He still has time to hear us when we cry out. Also interesting is the fact that Jesus did not lay hands on the 10. No, He simply said, go show yourself to the priest. Now if we read Leviticus 13, you will understand the detailed regulations about Jewish priests. And only the Jewish priest could declare somebody healed. And now Jesus brings these guys to a crisis of faith. And I think, John, this is a word for you. Human nature dictates some kind of action. But all Jesus did was to speak. He says, go. And these guys did not argue. They did not say, no, Jesus, please just touch us so we really know. Or they could have said, no, but if you don't heal me, I'm not going. You have not even healed us. No, instead, they head off to the priest. Because they built on Jesus' words. They stepped out in faith. They obeyed Jesus. And then they experienced healing power. Jesus just gave them a word. And boom. They didn't stand there and say, well, after you heal me, Jesus, then I'll go and show myself. No, they went straight. You see, that's the way faith works. Faith is trusting and obeying God even if you don't have a visible physical evidence to support your decision. But you know because you know because you know. I love the story in Matthew 4 about the disciples of Jesus out in the boat in the middle of a storm. And Jesus came walking on the water. They were terrified. They thought he was a ghost. But Jesus told them. And I paraphrase, don't be afraid. Simon Peter, who was always quick with his mouth, blurted out, "Lord, if it's really you, tell me to walk on the water with you. If." Jesus said, "Come on then. Come on. You do it." Now here's a picture of faith, because Peter started walking towards Jesus. And as long as he was walking on that word, he was fine. But then he started to think, because we think, and suddenly it starts to sink. Because suddenly, it's not about the word, it's about what am I doing. Let me tell you, when you're in faith, you do. You don't think always. Especially if God has spoken. Because as soon as we start to fly and work in faith, you start to think this is impossible. And as soon as you start to think it's impossible, your faith is dwindling. And that's when Jesus turned around and said, "Oh, come on here, you of little faith. Why did you begin to doubt?" My word today is, let's walk in faith. Faith is walking on the word of God. Faith doesn't need any evidence. It simply obeys. The Bible is full of God's directions. How to live. How to accomplish stuff. Our job, though, is to stop thinking and saying things and start to do. Coming to church. Are we coming to receive, or are we bringing to the King? We're a community of people bringing, not taking. Yes, of course, there will be times that we take. But that's the beauty of a relationship. Everybody gives 100% to recover one another. Next one is surrender all to Jesus. How easy is that to say that? Imagine the scene with me on the way to the priest. One of the lepers looked and said, "Hey, mate, look, you haven't got leprosy anymore. Look, your skin's clean." And suddenly they start to jump. And that's where I wanted to say leaping lepers. But the fact of the matter is they start to leap, most probably. Really happy. You mean, can you see them jumping up and down? However, we lose track of 9 at that moment. And only one. Do the right thing. The 9 were still healed. They were still going to their families, most probably. We don't even know if they went to the priests. But the fact of the matter is, there's only one who turned back. Because that one who turned back wanted a relationship, not a religion. You see, it's easy to have a spiritual idea in our mind, to have a religion. But when it comes to relationship, it becomes messy. It becomes a family thing. And let me tell you, there's no ideal family in the world, because we're all humans with different ideas. But this guy decides it's time to make a change. And what did he do? Scared to say, he fell down at the feet of Jesus, which is a picture of submission and worship. Think about it. Mary sat at the feet of Jesus. The woman at Simon's house spent time at the feet of Jesus, washing his feet with her tears. In the book of Revelations, the 24 elders who represent all the redeemed of all the ages will bow down before the Lamb who's on the throne. It's good to spend time at the feet of Jesus. Here's the key principle. 10 men were exposed to God's power. One sought a relationship. 9 men were content to receive the blessing of God that's now in the flesh. One decides, not only do I want it in the flesh, but I want it for eternity. The one kept the good. 9 kept the good. 1 looked for the best. The best is relationship. And let me tell you, 21 years of being a Christian has taught me that very few are really interested in a relationship with God. There's a lot of people who observe. There's a lot of people who just, what can do God do now for me? See, one of the key things with the Chinese church that we heard last week, the first thing they say to people is, this is a material world that's worth nothing. You are preparing for the eternity with Jesus. When last did we say that to people? Or is it, oh, God is blessing me financially. God is giving me healing. I'm not saying that's not the thing, but it's more than that. Have we got God on the emergency dial? Bail me out, bail me out. Or do we really have time when we just sit with God? When last did you pray 10% of your hours a day? Any case. Feeling thankful is different than living in gratitude. The man threw himself at the feet and he thanked him. And then Jesus says a weird thing and say, were there not 10 who were cleansed? Where's the other 9? As if. And now note his next words, because it is identifying himself as God. Says, he asked, was no one found to give praise to God except this foreigner? So immediately Jesus is showing his kingship, his authority. And remember, he's on his way now to be crucified. When the man, I believe God is still silent by how many people actually express true thankfulness and gratitude to him. But the Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 5:18, one of my favorite verses, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. People sometimes ask me and say, Sir Gustav, how can I find God's will for my life? And the answer normally is to read the Bible. When you do, you will realize that a life of gratitude towards God is the key. And that gratitude is in all circumstances. It's when you have COVID, it's when you don't have COVID, it's when you are sick, when you don't sick, when you're poor, when you don't, it's poor. When you have lots of money, when you have no money, when you have a church building, when you don't have a church building, when all of that, there needs to be a gratitude in. It's difficult. I always want to say thank you, even if I have a bad hand. Because God too allows sometimes things happen to us. And it's normally my fault. But I like to say, Lord, why? But the Bible says no. Say thank you. Hebrews 13:15 say, through Jesus therefore let us continually offer to God the sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that confess his name. It says the fruit of lips, not a warm fuzzy feeling in your heart. Don't just feel it, tell God how you feel. Isn't it sad? Work with John 6.5 years. I don't even know how often I said, I really appreciate you. I'm coming clearly too late. Don't do the same with God. Let's make a decision for ourselves. Let's be determined to be the one man or the one woman who will return to express gratitude. A relationship with Christ will make us foreigners on the earth. Jesus pointed out that the one man who returned was a Samaritan, a foreigner. He acted differently than 90% of the other lepers. Another lesson for us, those of us who have entered into a relationship with Jesus don't act or think like other people. Not because we are religious or we are pharisaical, but because God calls us to be holy, to be different. And we do it not because we're scared, but out of gratitude. The Bible says, but our citizenship is in heaven. We eagerly await a Savior, from there the Lord Jesus Christ. Philippians 3:20. Do we live a life that shows a different dimension than earth? You see, it does not matter where we come from, it's our destination that's most important. You see, we can all be from Liverpool, from Merseyside, from the United Kingdom, but our main citizenship when you have turned to Christ as your Savior is heaven. That's why we often feel like foreigners in this world. Peter writes, I urge you as strangers and aliens in this world to abstain from sinful desires which war against your soul. You see, Romans 12 say, therefore I urge you, I beseech you to become living sacrifices. You know what I'm saying? We are alive. And one of the most difficult things is to be living sacrifices, to crucify me, myself, and I. And it's so easy to crawl off that altar, especially when you see it coming. And to have gratitude when the knife hits. We should be listening to different music than the world. Because submit to Christ and let Him finish the work in us. Final words in verse 19 is, he says, rise and go, your faith has made you well. Now concentrate on that word well. That well is the word sozo. Sozo in Greek, which means to be saved, to be cleared, to be made complete. It's the same word that the Philippian jailer used in Acts 16 when he said, what must I do to be saved? That saved is sozo. The word means to be made complete or whole. So what do you think? Why did Jesus come to earth? His primary goal was not to heal our temporary, physical, or worldly illness. However, he did heal numerous people and physical ailments. And he saved us. His main intention, though, is to come to this world to seek and save the lost. He came to make people whole. He came to make you and I sozo. Death has lost its sting. We see from this miracle, 10 men were cleansed, but only one came to get sozo. Relationship with Jesus means to have sozo. That empty holes get filled with stuff that we don't even know where it comes from. But there's a certain amount of satisfaction. You see, Jesus wants to do more than clean us up. He wants to make us, you and me, whole and complete. Philippians 1:6 say, he who began a good work in you will carry it on until the day of Christ Jesus. It's a process. I don't know why you came to church today. I know that God is here today because His Word states He is everywhere, always. Hence, it makes sense that He will be in the midst of even one or two. But there's one little thing. He's in the midst of one or two who comes together in God's name. It's not about numbers, although it's lovely to have loads of people. It's about the depth of the relationship. It's about the growing in Christ. It's about serving one another. It's about iron sharpening iron. I also know that today God wants to make you whole. Do not waste this opportunity. Let's briefly consider the following. Make it a private prayer. Let us recognize humankind have a daily problem. Sin. Let us admit it affects me and let us cry to Jesus to help. Learn to be quiet with God. Be quiet and hear what God is saying. But then, be really revolutionary and put what God said to you in action. you surrendered all to Jesus. How does your personal relationship with Jesus look like? Is it a 5-minute prayer in the morning, 3 verses reading? In the evening, I will do a bit more prayer tonight before I go to bed and fall asleep. There's nothing wrong to fall asleep in Jesus' arms, but is that enough? Is that a life of surrender? Decide to live a life of gratitude. Can you honestly say thank you, Jesus, to everything, even the lot of nonsense that sometimes in our lives? You made peace that maybe we are a bit foreign to this world. Maybe just a little bit odd. Not because we want to be odd or because we wear funny clothes, but actually because we have Christ as our Savior and the Holy Spirit as our guiding light. And one thing I really want to say to you is remember, the Bible says, knock. I knock on the door, but it's you and I that need to open that door. Do you live a surrendered life? Do you submit and allow God to finish the work that He started in you and me? Let me tell you that it sometimes hurts so good. Bless you all. Thank you so much. Who do I give this to? This to now. Okay.
Thanks, Gustav.